The FMO theory developed by Fukui is a general one that will explain a wide variety of chemical reactivity. To introduce the topic, let's choose a particular chemical reaction. We'll select the same one that was described in his original paper, that of electrophilic aromatic substitution. Specifically, we'd like to understand why a substrate, such as phenanthrene, undergoes electrophilic aromatic substitution, the hydrogen atom on position 9 being replaced by the electrophile. Why didn't the reaction take place elsewhere, anywhere else on the molecule, such as position 8, or its symmetry equivalent site number 1, or for that matter, any of these other positions? In order to understand that, we need to look at the reaction mechanism. It's a two-step mechanistic sequence. The first step is rate determining. In other words, this is the step we're going to need to pay attention to. This is the step that's going to determine which reaction pathway is followed. In that rate-determining step, it's an electrophile association step. The pi nucleophile reacts with this electrophile to make this carbocation intermediate. The second step is fast. It involves the loss of this hydrogen by an electrophile dissociation step to make the pi bond. In order to understand the selective reactivity or the differential reactivity that takes place, why the reaction takes place at position 9, instead of any other site, we need to look at the reaction coordinate diagram that's shown here. What must be true is in that rate determining step, the barrier to cross over for the reaction at position 9 must be lower than any of the other positions' reactivity at any of the other positions. If we look back at the very beginning of the reaction, we can anticipate that the slope leading to those transition states is going to be lowest for that reaction pathway that will give us substitution at position 9 or 10. Fukui recognized that, and he described the reaction as a process in which the frontier electrons and their electron density are going to play the guiding role in governing which of these transition states is going to be most easily crossed. In particular, he said it was the electron density distribution in the highest occupied pi orbital that is going to determine the most reactive position. That makes sense because the highest occupied pi orbital is going to be associated with the pi nucleophile of this rate determining step. Before giving the details of the theory, let's see how it does by comparing theoretical predictions to experimentation. Here's the description from Fukui's paper. He says, as can be seen in Table 1, there's perfect agreement between the calculation and the results of experimentation in the case of molecules such as naphthalene, anthracene, and in our case, the molecule we chose, phenanthrene. So here's Table 1, and in particular, this column gives the theoretical prediction. It does so by describing the positions in the molecule that have the highest density of electrons in the highest occupied molecular orbital. And so the molecule phenanthrene has the greatest electron density in the highest occupied molecular orbital at positions 9 and 10. Then he goes on and gives the experimental observations for a series of electrophilic aromatic substitution. Electrophilic aromatic substitution that involves halogenation, that involves nitration, and that involves sulfonation. In the case of phenanthrene, you can see that it's the position 9, or sometimes we get reaction at both position 9 and 10. In the case of halogenation and nitration, goes at position 9, and sulfonation goes at position 9 as well. At higher temperatures, where other reaction pathways can intervene, he notes that there's some substitution product that's observed elsewhere. He also describes oxidation, which similarly involves the same pi nucleophile that's involved in electrophilic aromatic substitution. And again, you can see that the oxidation takes place at those positions where the electron density in the highest occupied molecular orbital is the highest. So you can see that there's very good agreement between theoretical prediction and the experimentation. This is just one example. There are many cases like it that have now been developed. And given the strength of this model, the FMO model, it's worthwhile that we understand how it can be used in order to predict chemical reactivity.